Hello learners, today we are going to learn public sector enterprises. In earlier days, business organizations were managed only by private individuals. But there are certain problems that they have faced, like heavy investment. If heavy investment is to be made, means they find it so difficult. And another point is relating to the infrastructure. And they will enter into only to those business organizations which can earn profit. But we have other set of organizations also which is needed for or which is aimed for the welfare of the society. At this point of time, many enterprises were started by the government, including oil industry, steel industry, banking, finance, etc. So, in this lesson, we will learn meaning of public sector enterprises, characteristics of public sector enterprises, and different forms of public sector enterprises. What is meant by public sector enterprises? The business units owned, managed, and controlled by the central government, or state government, or local government are termed as public sector enterprises or public enterprises. It can be otherwise known as public sector undertakings. A public sector enterprise may be defined as any commercial undertaking owned and managed by the government with a view to maximize social welfare. That is, they have been started for the welfare of the society, that is for the public interest. Public sector enterprises have been started. Public sector enterprises consists of nationalized private sector enterprises, banks, life insurance corporations, and new enterprises set up by the government. New enterprises under that you can include Hindustan Mission Tools, State Trading Corporation, Gas Authority of India, etc. So, here once again I have shown the examples of public sector enterprises. Now, we have to learn the characteristics of public sector enterprises. It is a government-owned organization and government-managed organization. It is financed from government funds, usually for the welfare of the society. Public enterprises are functioning. If you want to start a post office in an interior area, if this work is given to private bodies, they cannot do that. But without any profit motive, government enterprises will do these type of functions in a proper way. Similarly, transportation, communication, etc. So, for the public welfare, what all activities can be conducted? It will be conducted by the public enterprises. Similarly, public utility services, that is what I have mentioned right now, relating to the setting up of telecommunication system, transportation system, electricity, etc. These are the public utility services which will be handled by the public sector enterprises. But as the fund is raised from the government, these enterprises have public accountability, that is public answerability. As it is owned by the government, excessive formalities are there. For forming, it has to get the approval of the concerned minister. So many other procedures. So excessive formalities are there relating to the public enterprises. Now, we can look at the difference between private sector enterprises and public sector enterprises. Main aim of the private sector enterprises is to maximize profit. But public sector enterprises' main aim is to maximize social welfare. And these enterprises ensure balanced development. Private sector enterprises are owned by private individuals. Public sector enterprises are owned by government. Private sector enterprises are managed by the owner or professional managers. Public sector enterprises are managed by the government. What about the capital in both these type of enterprises? Capital is raised by the owners either through loans or through private sources and by issuing shares in the case of private sector enterprises. But in the case of public sector enterprises, the capital is raised from the government funds and sometimes through public issues. Private sector enterprises operates in all areas with adequate return on investment, that is, profit is a major criteria. Public sector enterprises operate in basic and public utility sectors. Basic sectors, infrastructural facilities are being provided by the public sector enterprises. Forms of public sector enterprises include departmental undertaking, statutory corporation, and government company. In detail, we can explain departmental undertaking, that is, overall control of the Ministry of Government is there in departmental undertaking. It is financed and controlled as a government department. Departmental undertaking is suitable for activities where the government desires to have control. Coming to second form of public sector enterprises, statutory corporation or public corporation. Public corporation refers to a corporate body created by the parliament or state legislature by a special act which define its powers, function and pattern of management. In the case of statutory corporation, is wholly provided by the government. As examples of statutory corporation, you can include State Trading Corporation, Life Insurance Corporation of India. Coming to the third form of public sector enterprises, government company. 51% or more of the paid up capital is held by the government. Such a company can be called as a government company. Government company is registered under the Companies Act. Government company is fully governed by the provisions of the Act. Now we are moving to departmental undertakings in detail. It is the oldest among the public enterprises. Departmental undertakings are organized, managed and financed by the government. It is controlled by a specific department of the government. Each such department is headed by a minister. All policy matters and other important decisions are taken by the controlling ministry. Parliament lays down the general policy for such undertakings. Now it is time for you to look at the features of departmental undertaking. It is established by the government and its overall control rests with the minister. It is a part of the government, but it is managed like any other government department. Departmental undertaking is financed through government funds. Departmental undertaking is subject to budgetary control. Accounting and audit control is also there in the case of departmental undertaking. Its policy is laid down by the government. Departmental undertaking is accountable to the legislature. Proceeding to the merits of departmental undertaking. Departmental undertaking helps to fulfill social objectives. It is responsible to legislature. Economic activities of this undertaking is under the control of the government and contribution to the government revenue is also possible. Because everything that is funded by the government and the profit will go to the government. There is little scope of misuse of funds. Misappropriation of funds is not possible as there is heavy control from the government. Fulfillment of social objectives. As its merit, the government has total control over these undertakings. As such, it can fulfill its social and economic objectives. Opening of post office in far places, broadcasting programs for the development of the people is possible with the setting up of these form of organizations. As a merit, you can include departmental undertaking is responsible to legislature. Working of departmental undertaking is answerable by the concerned minister in the parliament. Interest of any particular group of public will not work in the functioning of the departmental undertaking. Departmental undertaking control over economic activities. It helps the government to exercise control over the specialized economic activities. Departmental undertaking can act as an instrument of making social policy and economic policy. As a merit of departmental undertaking, we can include it is contributing to government revenue. Surplus of the departmental undertaking belongs to the government. So, there is increase in the government income. But if there is any deficiency, it will be met by the government. There is little scope for misuse of funds. This is also a merit of departmental undertaking. Why this is happening? Departmental undertakings are subject to budgetary accounting and audit control. And possibility of misuse of these funds of the departmental undertaking is very less. Now proceeding to limitations of departmental undertaking. The influence of bureaucracy is always there in departmental undertaking. And there is excessive parliamentary control, lack of professional expertise, lack of flexibility and inefficient functioning is also there in some cases of departmental undertaking. As a limitation relating to the influence of bureaucracy of departmental undertaking, I would like to explain in this way. Government permission is required for taking all the decisions of the departmental undertaking. So, important decisions are getting delayed. Excessive parliamentary control is there. Too much parliamentary control created difficulties in day-to-day administration. Then, as a demerit of departmental undertaking, lack of professional expertise. The administrative officers who manage departmental undertakings do not have the business experience and expertise. Management not done in a professional manner in some cases. Lack of flexibility, that is, policies cannot be changed instantly in the case of departmental undertaking due to red tapeism. Inefficient functioning is there. Sometimes incompetent staff and lack of adequate incentive. Like wages, salary, bonus, etc. Coming to the second form of public sector enterprise, statutory corporation. Public corporation or statutory corporation refers to such organizations which are incorporated under the special act of the parliament or state legislative assemblies. Statutory corporations by the special act of the parliament, statutory corporations are formed and that act specifies the rules and regulations of statutory corporations, powers and functioning of it, management pattern and area of activity. In statutory corporation, you can include State Bank of India and Life Insurance Corporation. Now, what is the feature of a statutory corporation? It is an autonomous body and is free from government control relating to its internal management. But it is answerable to the parliament and state legislature. Statutory corporations has a separate legal existence. Its capital is wholly provided by the government. Statutory corporations are managed by board of directors, which is composed of individuals who are trained and experienced in business management. The members of the board of directors are nominated by the government. Statutory corporation is supposed to be self-sufficient in financial matters. But sometimes, if there is any necessity, it may take loan from the government. The employees of statutory corporation are recruited as per their own requirement, that is, as per their own terms and conditions, as specified in the Act and decided by the board. Coming to the merits of statutory corporations, these corporations are managed in an expert manner or efficient manner. Internal freedom or autonomy is there. Responsibility is also there for statutory corporations towards the parliament, and there is flexibility in its operation. Now proceeding to the merits of statutory corporation, expert management. These enterprises are run on business principles under the guidance of expert directors and experienced directors. Government has no direct interference in the day-to-day management of the statutory corporations. Decisions can be taken promptly without any obstacles or hindrance. In the case of statutory corporations, there is internal freedom or internal autonomy. Statutory corporations are responsible to Parliament. Their activities are watched by the press and the public. As such, they have to maintain a high level of efficiency and accountability. Statutory corporations enjoy adequate flexibility in their operation. This helps in ensuring good performance and it improves the results of its operation. Statutory corporations protect and promote national interest. The government is authorized to give policy directions to the statutory corporations under the provisions of the acts governing them. It is easy to raise funds in the case of statutory corporations. Why? Because government-owned statutory bodies are the statutory corporations. So, whenever fund is required, they can easily raise funds by issuing bonds or through the grants of the government. As a limitation of statutory corporation, I would like to say government interference is there. It is more rigid. Once decision taken, you cannot fluctuate from there. And commercial approach is ignored in most of the statutory corporations. Government interference. As a limitation, that is, excessive government interference is there in statutory corporation. Amendments can be made only by the parliament, so difficult to respond to the changing conditions in the case of statutory corporations. Little competition is there, lack of motivation for performance and ignorance of commercial principles. So, commercial approach is not at all there in the case of statutory corporation. Now, coming to the third form of public sector enterprises, that is government companies. A company in which 51% or more of its capital is held by central government or by state government, such a company can be regarded as a government company. Government companies are registered under the Companies Act 1956. It follows rules and regulations of registered company. Coming to the features of government company, it is registered under the Companies Act 1956. It has a separate legal entity, that is, it can sue and be sued. It can acquire property in its own name. The annual reports of the government companies are required to be presented in the parliament. The capital is wholly or partially provided by the government, because 51% or more of the shares are held by the government. It is managed by board of directors. All the directors or majority of the directors are appointed by the government. Government companies' accounting practices and audit practices are more like those of private enterprises, and its auditors and chartered accountants are appointed by the government. Employees are not civil servants. Government company regulates its personal policies according to the articles of association of the government company. Merits of government companies. It is so simple to establish a government company. Efficient working on business line is possible in the case of government companies. And there is efficient management and there is healthy competition also in the case of government companies. Limitation of government companies, that is lack of initiative in some cases, lack of business experience. And always policies will be changed and management will be changed that will affect the working of the government companies. Dear learners, we have learned meaning of public sector enterprises, characteristics of public sector enterprises and different forms of public sector enterprises. Thank you.
वर्ष 1989 में एक स्वायत्त संस्था के रूप में भारत सरकार के मानव संसाधन विकास मंत्रालय द्वारा स्थापित राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा संस्थान NIOS दूरस्थ शिक्षा की विश्व में सबसे बड़ी मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा प्रणाली है। 25 लाख से अधिक पंजीकृत शिक्षार्थियों के साथ NIOS देश विदेश में 1200 से अधिक व्यावसायिक और 5500 से अधिक शैक्षिक अध्ययन केंद्रों के नेटवर्क द्वारा शिक्षा वंचितों तक पहुंचने का प्रयास करता है।
जीवन ये प्रकाशित करने, राहों को आलोकित करने,
जीवन ये प्रकाशित करने, राहों को आलोकित करने, हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने, हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने,
अपना
जनमानस में शिक्षा और प्रशिक्षण से सामाजिक आर्थिक विकास को एक नई गति प्रदान की जा सकती है। इसी क्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए NIOS जन स्वास्थ्य में एक वर्षीय प्रमाण पत्र पाठ्यक्रम राज्य स्वास्थ्य समिति स्वास्थ्य विभाग बिहार के साथ प्रारंभ करने जा रहा है। इस पाठ्यक्रम का उद्देश्य होगा सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ताओं को शिक्षित और प्रशिक्षित करना। अगर आंकड़ों पर गौर करें तो लगभग 10 करोड़ की आबादी के साथ बिहार देश में जनसंख्या के आधार पर तीसरे स्थान पर है। राज्य का 2/3 भाग ग्रामीण क्षेत्रों में निवास करता है जो कि कुल जनसंख्या का 88.71% है। गौर करने योग्य तथ्य ये है कि आज बिहार में एक बड़ी आबादी पर डॉक्टरों की उपलब्धता का अनुपात बहुत ही कम है। इन आंकड़ों अनुपातों को ध्यान में रखते हुए जन स्वास्थ्य की सुविधाओं के सुगम निष्पादन का एकमात्र उपाय हो सकता है प्रशिक्षित सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ता। सामान्यतः सुदूर ग्रामीण अंचलों में कार्यरत एक प्रशिक्षित सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ता निवारात्मक तथा उपचारात्मक स्वास्थ्य सेवाएं प्रदान करता है जो कि मानव शरीर विज्ञान तथा क्रिया विज्ञान का आधारभूत ज्ञान और स्वास्थ्य स्वच्छता एवं पोषण विज्ञान की समझ भी रखते हैं। जन स्वास्थ्य का ये पाठ्यक्रम सफलतापूर्वक करने के बाद प्रशिक्षित सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ता संक्रामक असंक्रामक तथा जीवन शैली संबंधित रोगों सहित आपातकालीन स्थिति में किए जाने वाले उपायों और रोगों की रोकथाम करने में सक्षम होंगे। साथ ही प्राथमिक उपचार, औषधि विज्ञान, फार्मेसी तथा दवाओं के दुष्प्रभावों का व्यवहार ज्ञान प्राप्त कर सकेंगे। परिवार नियोजन तथा टीकाकरण सहित मातृत्व व बाल स्वास्थ्य पर मार्गदर्शन करने में भी दक्ष होंगे। आज बढ़ती जनसंख्या के अनुरूप डॉक्टरों का उपलब्ध न हो पाना एक विषम समस्या बन गई है। समय की मांग है ऐसे प्रशिक्षित कार्यकर्ताओं को तैयार करने की जो तत्काल ग्रामीण क्षेत्रों, अस्पतालों, नर्सिंग होम और स्वास्थ्य क्लबों में जन समुदाय की देखरेख कर सके। इसके लिए प्रत्येक गांव मोहल्ले से कम एक व्यक्ति को जन स्वास्थ्य के इस व्यावसायिक प्रशिक्षण कार्यक्रम के माध्यम से प्रशिक्षण देकर कुशल बनाया जाएगा। ये प्रशिक्षित कार्यकर्ता समाज में बहुउद्देशीय स्वास्थ्य रक्षक के रूप में कार्य करेंगे। स्वास्थ्य संबंधी जागरूकता, प्राथमिक उपचार के साथ आपातकालीन स्थितियों जैसे बाढ़ और भूकंप जैसी आपदाओं में ये कार्यकर्ता उपयुक्त उपचार करने में सक्षम होंगे। जन साधारण के लिए परिवार कल्याण, रोगों की रोकथाम, स्वास्थ्य विज्ञान, स्वस्थ पर्यावरण, पोलियो निवारण तथा एड्स जैसे विषयों को इस कार्यक्रम में प्राथमिकता के साथ समाहित किया गया है। NIOS के जन स्वास्थ्य पाठ्यक्रम से उन शिक्षार्थियों को भी औपचारिक रूप से प्रशिक्षित किया जा सकता है जो भविष्य में स्वास्थ्य कार्यक्रमों में सक्रिय भागीदारी करके एक बहुउद्देशीय जन स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ता के रूप में कार्य कर सकेंगे। इस प्रशिक्षण कार्यक्रम के लिए राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विद्यालय शिक्षा संस्थान द्वारा व्यावसायिक विषय जन स्वास्थ्य में प्रमाण पत्र पाठ्यक्रम हेतु बिहार राज्य के 38 जिलों में 149 प्रथम रेफरल इकाइयों और 533 प्राथमिक स्वास्थ्य केंद्रों में सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ताओं को प्रशिक्षण दिया जाएगा। इन इकाइयों और केंद्रों को निर्धारित मानदंडों के अनुरूप NIOS के अध्ययन केंद्र AVI के रूप में प्रत्यायित किया जाएगा। प्रत्यायन के उपरांत इन अध्ययन केंद्रों पर प्रशिक्षणार्थियों का नामांकन आरंभ होगा। केंद्र समन्वयक इन केंद्रों का संचालन करेंगे। केंद्र समन्वयक के मार्गदर्शन में केंद्रों का प्रत्यायन, प्रशिक्षणार्थियों का नामांकन, शैक्षिक गतिविधियां, प्रशिक्षण कार्यक्रम एवं परीक्षा कार्य NIOS द्वारा निर्धारित मापदंडों के अनुरूप निष्पादित किए जाएंगे। प्रवेश के लिए अभ्यर्थी की योग्यता 10वीं पास और कम से कम 3 वर्ष का सामुदायिक स्वास्थ्य कार्यकर्ता के रूप में अनुभव होना आवश्यक है। जन स्वास्थ्य के व्यावसायिक पाठ्यक्रम की अध्ययन योजना में 40% सिद्धांत एवं 60% प्रयोग और प्रशिक्षण होगा। इस पाठ्यक्रम के 3 भाग हैं: आधारभूत जीव विज्ञान, मातृत्व एवं बाल स्वास्थ्य की देखभाल और रोगों व आपातकालीन स्थितियों में निवारण एवं प्रबंधन। इसके अंतर्गत शरीर क्रिया विज्ञान, प्राकृतिक स्वास्थ्य, घरेलू उपचार, पोषण, योग और व्यायाम, गर्भावस्था के दौरान महिला की देखरेख, स्तनपान, राष्ट्रीय स्वास्थ्य कार्यक्रम, परिवार कल्याण कार्यक्रम, स्वास्थ्यकर्ता के उत्तरदायित्व, संक्रामक रोग एवं निवारक उपाय, प्राथमिक उपचार, फार्मेसी तथा औषधि प्रतिक्रिया, प्रबंधन एवं आपातकालीन स्थिति जैसे विषयों का अध्ययन किया जाता है। टीकाकरण, बेहोशी में बचाव का प्रबंधन, जलने और डूबने की स्थिति में आपातकालीन उपाय, हड्डी टूटने की स्थिति में रोगी का स्थानांतरण तथा प्राथमिक उपचार प्रमुखता से सम्मिलित है। योग की अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर स्वीकारता और महत्ता को देखते हुए इस पाठ्यक्रम में योग का अर्थ अष्टांग योग के विभिन्न चरणों और योगासनों के साथ साथ प्राणायाम की विधियों को प्रमुखता से सम्मिलित किया गया है। एक राष्ट्रीय लक्ष्य के रूप में सभी के लिए शिक्षा और स्वास्थ्य आज एक प्राथमिकता का विषय है। भावी प्रशिक्षणार्थियों की सामाजिक आर्थिक विषमताओं को ध्यान में रखकर तैयार किए गए जन स्वास्थ्य के इस पाठ्यक्रम के संचालन से एक नई व्यावसायिक प्रशिक्षण क्रांति को दिशा मिलेगी। जनमानस के विकास में राज्य स्वास्थ्य समिति बिहार और NIOS का यह संयुक्त प्रयास एक नई दिशा दिखाएगा और जन स्वास्थ्य के क्षेत्र में शिक्षा प्रशिक्षण का ये पाठ्यक्रम एक नई किरण बनकर समाज को रोशन करेगा। बड़े,